Good morning, everyone. How y'all doing? Let's all stand together. How about having this choir up here singing with us? In excelsis Deo. Glory to God in the highest. Each time you sing that, glory to God. Let's sing.
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply echo back their joyous strains. Gloria,
song this month. Let's sing this again. Behold. be seated. Job. It's great to see our choir back on a Sunday, and it's great to see you all here on a Sunday. Thank you so much for being here. We know that you could be many places on a rainy Sunday morning, but you're here. So thank you for coming and being a part of what we have going on here today. If you're a guest with us, thank you so much for being here. We truly mean that. We are honored that you would choose to join us on a Sunday, and we're glad that you're here. If you haven't checked in for worship yet, we'd love to ask you to do that. You can do that either in the church center app
app or on the QR code. You can scan the QR code that's on the seat back in front of you, and that'll take you to a place where you can check in. Not only that, you can submit prayer requests while you're there. So if there's anything that we can pray with you about or pray for you about, we would love to do that. We meet on a weekly basis as a staff, and we pray through those things. So if there's anything we can pray for you about, please submit that, and we'd be happy to pray for you. I'm excited about being here at church today, and there's a couple reasons for that. One is because, man, this is a place where people lift the name of Jesus high, right? Like, that's what we were just doing. Those songs, they're about Jesus. The people who are here, it's not about them. It's not about the worship team. It's about Jesus. That's the focus. And we do that because we believe the Bible teaches that he is worthy of our praise, that Jesus is the one who deserves the praise. He deserves the worship. He deserves the recognition. All of it that we can bring, he deserves all of it. He's the one that deserves it. His name, the name of Jesus, is the name that's worthy. We're here in the fellowship hall, right? We usually would be over in the auditorium, but it's being remodeled currently, if you didn't know that. And it's underway. And the whole purpose of that is it's all for the gospel. It's to continue to proclaim the worthiness of Jesus' name. That there's progress happening in there. They've already began to level out the stage. So it's all going to be opened up there. The production room up in the balcony is being framed in. That's going to make our online experience for those who watch online even better. There's going to be people who can host people while they're online. If people ask questions, there will be people who can respond to them in the moment. We're super excited about that, to make our online experience just that much better. But all of that is for the gospel. It's to proclaim the name of Jesus as worthy, and that's why we do it. So we're going to sing another song. If you would, stand to your feet. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing a song about Jesus and his own worthiness. Dear God, we love you, and we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here today. I ask that you'd bless this time of worship, that you'd bless Pastor Tony as he speaks and delivers the message. We're just so thankful for all that you've done and all that you're going to do in this service. God, we know that you are worthy of all the worship and all the praise and all the honor and all the glory that we can bring. So help each and every one of us to bring that today. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
This song is such a comfort. Let's sing this together.
deserve the praise. Worthy is your name.
Come on, sing.
Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name.
God, amen. Thank you. Please be seated.
His name is Wonderful Counselor, who guides us through the hills and valleys of life. His name is Mighty God, who harnesses his infinite power to give strength to the finite. His name is Everlasting Father, our faithful and forever protector and provider. His name is Prince of Peace, who calms the storm in our soul and leads us to still waters. His name is Man of Sorrows, who carries our shame and our pain and our guilt and our past. He's the Lamb of God, who lives and bleeds and dies in our place. He's the Lion of Judah, who fights for us the battles we could not fight on our own. He is the power of God, the wisdom of God, the glory of God, and the gift of God. And he is the Son of God. He's the Ancient of Days, who has no beginning and who has no end. He's the radiance of God's glory, the culmination of the perfection of God. He is the commander of God's army, with multitudes of angels bowing in reverence at the mention of his holy name. He's the living stone and the rock of ages. He's the root of Jesse and the son of David. He's the light of the world and the Lord of all. He's the King of Kings and the image of the invisible God. There's no one like him. He is undefeatable. He is non-repeatable. He is incomparable, and he is inescapable, and he is the great I Am, and he is worthy, worthy of our devotion, worthy of our worship, and worthy of his name, the name of Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
The name above all names.
I love that name. You talk about the name of Jesus, there's so many names that we worship at this time. And I want us to take this time very special. I want us to slow things down. I want us to zone in what we're doing. It is so easy for us that go to church all the time that we sometimes just get into a rhythm of just going through the motions of things. This was never intended to be just a tradition of the church. Christmas has a lot of traditions. Wrap gifts, sing carols, hot chocolate, Christmas Eve, matching pajamas, all those things are great. This is way more than a tradition that we do as a family. This is where we call to our mind what this is all about. This is the foundation of life. This is the foundation of Christmas. It's the foundation of our salvation, is understanding that Jesus is the reason for not just the season, he's the reason for everything. Everything. As we come to this time, there's something that we need to understand. We call this the Lord's Supper, we call this communion. But the reason why it's communion, because we sit down in fellowship with what he's done. We're reminded of the gap that was between us and how God made it close for us to be in his presence, because sin is what separated us. Sin is what held us back. There's, in the story of Jesus coming in the Christmas story, he says, "Behold, a virgin shall be with a child, and she'll bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel." And then he gives us the definition. It says, which being interpreted is God with us. The point of Christmas was communion. God with us. God is with us right now. So in your seat, it's not that we're standing at the manger, but we are in the presence of our Jesus. We are in the presence of our God. Through the Holy Spirit of God, we're able to fellowship and worship and love and be able to respond to the things that he's doing. So let's not just go through the motions of this. If you are a guest with us and you know the Lord Jesus Christ is your personal Savior, you know that, please join us in being part of this today. If you have kids in the room and they don't understand what this is all about, don't have them go through the motions of this. It causes confusion. This is for those that are saved and know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. The bread represents the body of Jesus Christ. It's symbolic. It represents. It brings us back. It's something to help us to focus and bring to our mind what Jesus did at that Last Supper when he was talking about giving his life for us. The juice represents the blood of Jesus Christ. It represents the death. It represents the fact that he gave his life for ours. And so we do this a lot as a church, a lot as Christians, but we do this in remembrance of what he's done. I'm going to invite our men to make their way down to the front. You imagine as Mary and Joseph were the first ones to experience Jesus as Emmanuel, God with us. Because in that stable, in the manger that day, they held the very presence of Jesus. To be able to look at his face, to talk to him, to share life, to watch him grow up. And I know for us, we sometimes separate and say, well, Jesus is in the manger. Man, the Bible says this. It says, God is faithful by whom we are called unto fellowship of his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through salvation, we have that same fellowship. So I just want to encourage you during this time to enjoy this presence, this fellowship that we have. And by doing that, it's not just sitting in your seat. As we take the elements, as we pass the juice and the bread around, that is your time to reflect, to pray, just to meditate on the things of God. At the door, we are going to pass out the elements. We did, just as we announced last week, we do have the pods. If you feel more comfortable with that, we still have those available if you want to partake of the Lord's Supper in that way. But we'll also be passing out the elements at this time. So let's pray. I'm going to ask Pastor Bryce if he'll lead us in prayer as we get started.
Let's pray. God, we love you, and we're just so thankful for the opportunity that we have to be here today and to participate in communion. And we're aware of what it means and the fact that your body was broken, that your blood was spilled on our behalf, and that it should have been our bodies that were broken. It should have been our blood that was spilled. And yet you did that for us. We know that this is just a time for us to remember that. And I hope and I pray and I ask that it would not become a ritualistic thing for anybody here, but that we truly would think of the grace that you offer to us, that we would keep in mind how good you are in providing a son, providing someone who could take the punishment that we could not pay, take the debt that we could not pay. God, we're so thankful for your grace and for your mercy. We love you, but we know that that's only because of how you've loved us first. God, we thank you for this time, and I ask that you bless it. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
One of the most obvious things that we do at Christmas is gifts. Start planning while out, get ready for the Amazon deliveries, try to stash them in your house so the kids don't see it, your spouse.
We just love that part. Kids wake you up before you wake up on Christmas. They never do that for school, but they'll do that on Christmas. They're excited about those gifts. And I've had people say that can be distracting at Christmas. It can be if the focus gets off. But if you go back to the beginning of the mission of Jesus coming, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He sacrificially gave to show his love to meet a need. We do that at Christmas. We show love by giving to one another. Jesus was the gift that we needed. He came, the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. He put it in our language. He wants us to understand. He wants us to get it, that he paid the price for it. He sacrificed for it. Now he extends it to us. And when he was in the upper room, he was with the disciples, and he had said, and when he had given thanks, he break it, talking about the bread. As after he said, this is my body, he said this, and he says, and take, eat. Imagine as Jesus is sitting there saying, I'm the sacrifice. I'm what you need. I'm going to pay the price for this. Take to receive it. This reminds us that we're saved because we accepted the free gift of salvation, of what Jesus Christ did in our hearts. And the rest of that verse says, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.
Heavenly Father, as we gather together this morning as a church around your table, Lord, we're thankful for your broken body and for your shed blood. Lord, we're thankful that you sacrificed so that we could be forgiven. Lord, I pray that as we go forward in this season, that your sacrifice and your love for us will be very evident in the way that we treat each other, in the way that we talk, in the way that we respond. Lord, we want to show others your love. And so as we worship together today, Lord, may it be a time of reflection. May it be a time of deep worship, because you're worthy. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
they were talking about Jesus in Matthew. He was described as Emmanuel. That giant gap that was between us and God, God says, now I'm with you. But when he was described as the shepherds, they said, for unto you is born this day a Savior. Came to rescue us. Came to deal with the sin that separated us. I know most of you know this, that this symbolism of this is when Jesus died on the cross and he said, it is finished. The veil was rent, which separated them from the Holy of Holies, or the presence of God. It was all symbolic that there's no more separation, because the blood of Jesus Christ was shed for our sins. All of that meant something. It all was symbolic when the disciples were all coming together in the beginning of Jesus' ministry and everything that was happening, and Jesus started with baptism, John the Baptist, and all that. He was introduced as the Lamb of God that would take away the sins of this world. We'll rewind a little bit. Who was the first ones to be told? It was the shepherds. Where was Jesus born? In the manger, surrounded by sheep. All of that was not an accident, because there was no room in the inn. I mean, that's true. But it was symbolic for us to understand that he didn't come at that point to be the conquering king. He came to conquer our sin. He came to give his life. He came to be the lamb that would be shed, that would be killed, that his blood would be shed for us. So this represents the life that we have. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin to give us that everlasting life. So Jesus was with them. It says, and after the same manner, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this is the cup of the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as often as you drink, do it in remembrance of me. God, we thank you, Lord, that you showed your love to us by giving your Son. Lord, we have salvation today because of what you did. Lord, you made a way. You paid the price. You eliminated the gap. And God, as we spend this time in fellowship with you, Lord, help us to never get so caught up in the traditions that we forget about the reason. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for being salvation, that hope, that gift. Thank you for being life. Lord, thank you for giving us hope. So, Lord, as we celebrate this, Lord, help us to put our focus and attention on you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's all stand and sing.
God sent his Son.
Thank you so much for the mercy that you sent our way, that withheld the punishment that we very much deserve. And we are so thankful for the grace that took that punishment and put it on your Son, Jesus, so that we can know that we are saved. Thank you for this time of year that reminds us that your son came to us as a baby and grew and lived that life that we follow and study and pattern after, but most of all, to save us from our sin. We thank you for this time of communion that we have had, that where we have been in remembrance of that. We thank you so much. We are a grateful people. Thank you so much for this service today. And I pray that as we continue, our hearts would be wide open to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Take your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 12. We have gone a number of weeks studying through chapter 11. And there's application. There's got to be application for us to gather in church and take the Word of God and study what God's saying to our hearts. And then walk out of here the same literally means that we did not receive what God said for us to receive. The Word of God changes us. The Word of God speaks to us. It is the very words of God that speaks to our hearts to tell us what He has next and what He has planned for us. And for us to face life, and we all face life, and for us to look back at what God did in the lives of all these people in the Bible, and for us to think those are cool stories. No, those are cool principles for us to apply to our life, because as a parent, life is not easy. And marriage life is not easy. And ministry and pastoring and jobs, whatever, life is not easy. So God said that the way that you are to live is by faith. And faith is trusting God that He's going to guide me and bring me through whatever I'm facing. Because faith is the substance of things hoped for, but the evidence I can't see. So the only way that I know that we're going to get through whatever's coming next or whatever is going to happen in 2024 is I know with confidence that I can step forward and I can make a move and I can trust God, because I know as long as I'm walking in the light and I'm walking with God that God's already there, that God's got a plan and that God's with me. But when we have Christians that live in fear and we step out saying, I don't know what's happening, and if so-and-so gets to become president and all this other stuff, where's your confidence? Because if it's not in God, you're going to run the other way. Right. If we don't have faith in God, we will never step forward by faith to do whatever God has for us. Because this world is changing fast. And God is not done with you. He's not done with your family. He's not done with your marriage. He's not done with Fellowship Baptist Church. And He's not done with me. God's not finished. But the only way we're ever going to experience what God has next for us is we've got to, in our hearts, in our heads, know that God's in control, that I'm going to step forward. When the storms come, I'm going to step forward. When life's falling apart, I'm going to step forward. When the economy changes, because the only way to move forward is by faith. That's right. Yes. But how do you do that? Because a lot of people receive the messages, that sounds great. If everybody was stepping by faith, we'd have moves of God all over the place. We would be experiencing God healing in our marriages and healing and working in our churches and doing the things that we want God to do to bring revival and bring change. Because remember, without faith, it is impossible to please God. It's impossible. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's the rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You want the reward? You want to see the manifestation of the power of God? You want to see, and this isn't name and claim it. This is not me declaring it. God's just saying, walk by faith. It's as much for you as it was for the people in the Bible. Notice this. Hebrews 11, you say, Pastor Tony, I'm not that person. I didn't grow up in church. Man, because sometimes we have this thought that I'm walking into a room with a bunch of people that have all figured out, you know. Like these people that stand on the stage, they got it all figured out. For these people that know the songs, they don't have to keep staring at the screens and all this, they have it all figured out. But I want you to understand that, know my heart when I say this. When it comes to faith, none of us have what it takes. Nope. None of us. And I think that's the thing. It's like, I'm going to do it this time, and I'm going to have a better year, and I'm going to be like Abraham. I'm going to be like Joshua. I'm going to have that faith of Noah. But I'm telling you, you don't have what it takes.
And that's why we fail so many times, because we make up in our mind, I'm going to do it this time. This is it. I'm going to be that man of God. I'm going to be the husband. I'm going to live it out in front of my kids. That's why we need Hebrews 12 to wrap things up. It says Hebrews 12, 1, wherefore? The wherefore is talking about, let me continue the thought of what we just read about all these people of the Bible that lived out their faith. Remember what you just, wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. This is, you've got the story of Rahab that fell, was in sin and living in a pagan society, and God saved her and God used her. You've got the story of Jacob that messed up, but you've got that story. You've got Abraham that was a friend of God. You've got Noah that built a boat in the middle of a crazy situation. You've got this great cloud of witnesses, great crowd of examples, giving us examples of what God can do. We're surrounded by this. And this passage that we're familiar, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. But the part of this that I want you to understand, after it talks about everybody in the Bible, it says this twice in this passage, let us. It's not just about what God has done. It's not just about the people that God has used. There's application to it that God says, let Fellowship Baptist Church, let 2024 be a year to experience God working in us. So whoever you are, this passage applies to you, that God's talking about. It's our turn to live by faith. It's our turn to run the race, to face the challenges, to embrace the mission. Some of us are like, I want it so bad. I want to trust God. But man, it's such a challenge. It's a challenge for all of us. So let me close this series out of just simply putting it like this. This is how to live by faith. Without these steps right here, it's just not going to work. Number one, here is looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. This applies to everyone here. Here's how to live by faith. You've got to go to the source of faith. You've got to go to the source. It's never going to be found in a church building. It's never going to be found in a pastor. It's never going to be found in a life group. It is Jesus and only Jesus. Now, I know we go to church to find Jesus, but let me tell you, Jesus is everywhere. It's not just in the spiritual things that we lift up in our lives. Jesus is the author of our faith. He's the source, the supply, the originator. It's not about you trying harder. It's not trying to change your mind. Faith is a work that God does in our hearts. It is about faith. It is about what God does in our lives. It is what God wants to do in our lives. Nate, you got a minute. Can you come up here, Brother Lapish? Yes, sir. Come up here. Let me demonstrate this to you. Now, here's what the Bible says. Like, okay, if Jesus is the originator, that's where it comes from. Help me with this. All right, you got your Bible. So the Bible says this. Okay, open your Bible. This is what the Bible says. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So when we say, where is the originator? Where does faith come from? It comes right from this. Now, if we come to church, this is what we do. We're going to the source of this, but this is what's cool. This is not just a book. This is the very words of God. Do you understand that every time Nathan does this and he's sitting in there studying the word of God as the preacher is preaching it, God is speaking not just to Nathan, but to Nathan's heart. This is where it starts. To just get out of the boat and say, I'll follow you. No, it doesn't start there. Just, I'm going to make up my mind to be a better Christian. It doesn't start there. It starts right here, because faith, literally, it's the Bible says, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So this is what happens. This is how it translates. When you think, I'm not that type of person, or I don't have what it takes, this is what God is doing. God is literally, as we're doing this, speaking to our hearts, saying, Nathan, I did it then. I'll do it in you. To be the man of God that you need to be, you've got to put me first. Nathan, I know you're scared, and I know life is challenging, and I know what you're out there, but I tell you, when you listen to me, I will make your way straight. I will open doors. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We're listening to the words of God hit our heart. That is why it's so important that you go to a Bible-preaching church. It has to be where they say, take your Bibles, this is what thus saith the Lord says, and we live it, because it's the same thing in worship. As we're worshiping, man, we put our attention on Jesus, and as we're worshiping and proclaiming the names of Jesus Christ, and I love the names of Jesus Christ, God in that presence is saying, that's who I am. I know you're scared. But remember, as you're taking communion, I died for your sins. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Thank you, Nate. That is it. So all the things that we try to do and try is like faith is an action and faith is getting out of the boat and faith is moving forward. Nothing makes sense. And faith is putting God first and all the different things that we've learned about faith. But I'm telling you, you've got to go to the source of faith because it is God that speaks to your heart as a dad to tell you he's got it when you don't. Let me give you an illustration of this. Take Peter getting out of the water. Imagine him in the boat and the storm is raging and they're just trying to hold on for dear life. Jesus comes walking on the water. Jesus calls out to Peter, calls out to the disciples, says, I be not afraid. And then he says to him, Peter, come out of the boat because Peter said, can I come to you? Why in the world did he have the guts to be able to do what was impossible? Because he listened to the voice of his God. So the rest of the disciples are out there like, Peter, we don't walk on water. Peter, that's Jesus, not you. Peter, and he got out. You say, why is that possible? Peter got out of the boat, looked at him and said, because he said I could. That is where our confidence comes from. He is the author of our faith. He's the originator of our faith. If you're going to any other resource to try to find this, let God speak to your heart. Because when you read the word of God and you worship God and you study the word of God and you hear the preaching, God speaks to our heads that reaches to our hearts to change you from the inside out. So when you're facing not getting out of the boat, but you're facing whatever job God's going to give to you or ministry opportunity or being a dad when you've never been a dad, God speaks to your heart and says, follow me, I've got this. But it doesn't just say that. The Bible goes on to say, that, explaining this, that he's the author of our faith, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. He is not only the author of your faith, Jesus is the sustainer of your faith. Trust in the sustainer of your faith. This is just laid out clearly in this passage. He is the author. Literally, this is where it starts. God speaks to our hearts. He originates this. But then he is the finisher of our faith. You know what finished means? When God called you to be a parent, and God calls you into marriage, and God calls you into ministry, and God calls you to whatever it is, God says, I'm going to see you through. That's what the finisher of your faith is. He not only starts it, the Bible literally means the finisher literally means he completes it. God is in the journey with you. Just make sure the journey you're on is from God. A lot of times it's all falling apart. It's like God says, I didn't put you there. I didn't bring you to that. I didn't have you date that person. I didn't put you in that job. I didn't pull you from God in that way. Trust in the sustainer of your life. It's the author and finisher of your faith. God doesn't fail. I take you to the story that we did, and we went into detail. When God brought them to the Red Sea, God opened the Red Sea, God brought them to the other side, and then the army is charging towards them, and you're thinking, what am I going to do? God says, I started this. I brought you here. I will finish this. And God brought the waters back over their enemies, and in front of their eyes, they were able to see the deliverance of God covering their past. For the rest of their life, they're not looking over their shoulders. God saw them heal their past. It's easier said than done. The Bible says, being confident in this very thing, that he which began a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Whatever journey you are on, God's going to see you through. Now, we've got to remember this because we lose sight in the middle of the journey. Man, I'm preaching to myself as we do this. So this coming Thursday, we go to Cleveland Clinic to get scans. These will be the first scans after radiation. First scans after all this craziness. And we're just going to go in. We don't know what to expect whatsoever. And it could be blurred because of the inflammation of the cancer, because of the radiation. But sometimes it's just like, oh, I hate seeing anybody that's ever been through this. Scans are terrible because it unveils things that you don't know. And then God reminds me, Tony, how did you get to Cleveland Clinic? That's right. I brought you there. Tony, how did you even have radiation? They said it was impossible. I made that happen. How are you talking about surgery on January 5th when the doctor at OSU said surgery is not an option? Now you have a date for surgery. I did that. You know why? Because he's not only the author of our faith, he's the finisher of our faith. He brings us through it. But the thing is, I have to trust God all through it. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. But notice this, in verse 2, he says, looking unto Jesus. The trick, the tool, the importance of this is you've got to keep your eyes on Jesus. This is so important. As you're walking by faith, you're going to get distracted by everything. Do you know how easy it is to look to the left and the right and for your heart to fail? Now, I think of this with Peter. Let me go back to Peter walking on the water, because I think that's a huge visual of God calling us by faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. I hear you, Lord. I'm going to do something crazy that I would not normally do because I trust in the voice of the one calling me, okay? So here Peter is getting out of it, but did he make it all the way to Jesus without failing? Who can tell me? No, he didn't. He sunk. Now, did he sink because he kept his eyes on Jesus? He sunk because he took his eyes off of Jesus. As he's walking to Jesus, he got distracted with the waves and the thunder and the lightning and maybe even the voices behind him going, Peter, you're crazy. What are you doing, bro? You know, just like, this isn't going to work out. It is so easy sometimes to start the faith journey. And then you listen to the voices, you see the things around us and, you know, the stats and the statistics and all these things. And we've had our dips up and down as we've gone through this crazy journey. In 1 week last year, I did 3 funerals. All 3 people died of cancer. For when you're going through this and you're just constantly reminded, it is easy to be like, oh, you know, you get so focused. Here's the thing. This is what Jesus wanted Peter to do as he's walking through the storm, as it's raging, all this, the sass, the statistics, the people, the doubts, all these things around. Jesus is saying, Peter, right here, buddy. Who called you? Who told you to get out of the boat? Who's taking every step on water by faith? Put your eyes on Jesus. And I'm telling you, if you don't keep your focus on Jesus next year, you will fall and sink. Do you know why he had to put this in passage? Because this is not what we normally do. When the doctor tells you this, when the society tells you this, when stats tell you this, Jesus said, whoa, wait a minute, tune those things out. I'm the author and finisher of your faith. You better look unto me. This is where your focus comes. Pastor Tony, I'm trying. I'm trying so hard, but I feel like I'm falling. I do good 1 week, and then I fall apart the next week. Let me go back to verse 1 again, okay? Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside the weight in the sin which so doth easily beset us. This is a running illustration. Now, here's what's interesting about this passage. How many of you have heard somebody preach about running the race and preach that before? Raise your hand. You're in church, just everybody, okay. It's not your first time. You're not like, I've never heard this. But here's what's interesting to me. Oftentimes, we just preach Hebrews 12, 1 by and 2 by itself, but not comparing it to Hebrews 11. Do you understand when he said, I'm the author and finisher of the faith, he's looking back at what everything that happened in chapter 11. He's talking about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And he's like, that's cute. Let me show you how this actually happens. Don't put your eyes on Abraham and Isaac. Don't even inspire. I mean, David can inspire us. And I said, one day I hope to have the faith of David. That's great. I hope that I can live out and have a story like David. But I'm not David. And you're not Rahab, you're not Esther, you're not all these other people. I've got to understand that God's got a story for me. They're the example, but the whole focus and attention is looking unto Jesus, and he's given this example that a lot of you are failing and falling on your face, and he gives this running illustration. He said, you know what's happening? You're trying to run and live the life in a way that you weren't created. He said, you've got to lay aside the weights and the sin which so does easily beset us. Now, take the application of this. He didn't just say sin, because a lot of times we go, I know sin will mess me up. There's no way that I'm going to be able to walk this journey when I'm living in sin. But he said the weights. I'm not a runner. I never claimed to be a runner. But I can tell you I've done the 5Ks, and that's where I tap out right there. You know, it's just not my thing. I get winded just running through the church to, you know, get to the other side. I'm not that type of person. But I do know this, if you're going to run the race, if you're going to run any kind of 5K or half marathon or marathon, you take everything off that's going to weigh you down. If not, you get worn out before you even need to, because the weights that are on you wear you out. Now think about this. What is weighing you down from being able to spend time with God? If Nathan doesn't have to come up here, but let me just illustrate. If this is where faith comes from, because God speaks to my heart, God speaks to my head, God speaks to the inner man, God, the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to dividing asunder of soul and spirit. This is where life change happens. This is where men go from being an apathetic dad to a passionate dad. This is where that mom that says, I'm just trying to keep my head above water, to coming to being a person of faith. It starts right here. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And faith is moving forward when nothing makes sense. The only way you're ever going to have it is right here. But all of us will admit, Pastor Tony, I know that's true, but I'll go an entire day and not have time for this. I'll go a week and not have time for this. If we're going to run the race, it is time to set some things aside. Let go of the things that hold you back. You have to. It's not just the sin. The Bible is talking about the weights that hold us back. It could be that sport that runs you ragged, that you're exhausted all the time. It could be that overtime that you're pushing for all the time. It could be the trips that you do. It could be Netflix. It doesn't have to be sin. The Bible says to lay aside the sin and the weights. Anything that's going to hold you back from running the race because you're not tapped into the one that gives you the strength, it's time to lay some things aside. And the sin. A lot of us have messed up. There's things from your past that you say, I know I am so ashamed of the things that I've done. I've made mistakes in my life. And you are held back by that. It's easy to say, just let it go. But can I illustrate this for a minute? You know, the Bible was saying in verse 2, it says, for the joy, listen to this, for the joy that was set before him. Do you know who the joy was that was set before him? This is how you lay aside the weight. We're holding on to this. This, whatever this is guilt. I was a terrible parent growing up. My kids don't listen to me. They hate my guts. They'll never listen to me about God. This is that guilt. Maybe it's the fact that you've been divorced and you made it happen because you messed up so much. You're not used in ministry now because you've made so many mistakes that when you think about getting on the stage to sing in the choir or be part of a teaching class or whatever, you're consumed with guilt because of what you've done. And you're held back. David was held back. He said, my sin is ever before me. I can't let go of this. So it's weights and sin. But whatever it is, you're not running the race. You're not pushing forward. You're not doing the things that God wants you to do because you're so consumed. And no matter what, you say, I know God forgives and I know God is good. I know God is faithful, but I can't get over this. Lay aside is tied into verse 2. For the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Listen to this, despising the shame. You've got to understand what God is saying here. He's saying, yes, you can lay it down, because whatever that weight is that you're holding on to, he took that shame. He took that embarrassment. He said, let me have it. Let me have it. He took it, died on the cross because of the joy. You are the joy. You are the love that he's talking about in John 3:16. Because he's saying, I'm tired of Christians not running the race and reflecting back at the people of the Old Testament and not living it out for themselves because they're consumed with what they had. So listen to this. He said, for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the same shame, and is set down at the right hand of the Father. So this is what Jesus did. Get the visual of this, because the running thing is a visual of this. He took whatever that was, the shame. They stripped Jesus on the cross. We try to make it cute. He was brutally murdered, stripped, and embarrassed. Shameful death on the cross as a thief when he was the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It doesn't matter how bad the embarrassment is from your shame of your past. God took it on the cross. He died on the cross. We just remembered that through the blood that we talked about. He died. He paid for it. They took the body of Jesus off the tomb. That literally, your sin was crucified. They stuck it in a tomb. It was buried. But Jesus came out victorious. Do you understand where he's at now? The Bible says this. Look at the verse. And is set down at the right hand of the Father. He sat down because it's finished. Why are you holding on? Why are you holding on? Why are you trying to run as a mom with that guilt from the past? Why are you holding on to the mistakes of your past? God looks at us literally saying, look unto me. I'm sitting down because it's been dealt with. I paid for it on the cross when he said it is finished. The visual of that is he's up in heaven, not trying to deal with your sin, sitting at the right hand of the Father saying, it's already been dealt with. Stop trying to run with what you weren't created to have. Your sin is paid for. It's covered under the blood of Jesus Christ. And the last thing that he says in there is it's time to run. Let us run with patience. You know what the word patience means? Endurance. You don't have to run from January then fall on your face in February next month or next year. You don't have to do that. Bible says, I'm going to give you the faith where God's working in our lives that he said, I'm the author, I'm the finisher. I will help you raise your kids. I will get you through that ministry. I will restore whatever's broken. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. So just to clarify, you don't have it. You don't have what it takes. You don't have it in you. You can keep trying and keep trying. You know where it's found? He's the author and the finisher of your faith. He does it through you. Heads bowed and eyes closed. We're not gonna sing a song this morning because there's no way that I can take this and focus on God talking to your heart and not spend this time God talking to your heart. So right now, normally I would lead people through a prayer. So I'm going to do this in a different way for you guys. It's not necessarily for salvation. If you don't know Jesus Christ, then call on him from your seat. Same thing as everybody online. Call on him from your seat, from your car, from the job that you're working right now. God meets us where we're at. But in your seat right now, what is holding you back from running the race? Running implies passion. It means stop looking back. It means to pursue with passion and zeal and conviction, not to stroll through life or constantly say, I'm just trying to make it. God said, I didn't save you to try to make it. Stop just trying to make it. When you were made to run the race with endurance. So the question that I'm asking for everybody in here and the people online, what is holding you back? It is something that you've consumed your life with that holds you back, that is a weight, something that you've added to your life that needs to be set aside this year, or a sin, and you know what it is. And if you don't know what it is, I promise you, in the prayer time right now, say, God, show me what's holding me back, because he's got a plan for you, and it's just as cool as David and Goliath. It's just as real as Joshua and Jericho. It's just as life-changing as Rahab. It's just as redeeming as Jacob. It's just as big as Noah and the Ark. It's your story. It's time that the people of Fellowship Baptist Church, it's time that God's people move forward by faith. So in the quietness right now, reflect between you and God. Am I walking by faith? Or am I in my comfort zone? Am I settled? Am I sitting? Am I weighted down? Am I held back? God, we pause at a time like this, not to take notes, not to sing the words, but to look to you. God, you started the journey that we're on, and you're going to finish it. You're the author, the originator, the beginning, and you will complete it. So, Lord, as we take this crazy journey, Lord, I know that life can be complicated. Lord, help the moms and the dads in this room to have it in their heart that they're going to take steps of faith this year. Lord, help the teens to know that they were made more than to just exist and finish school. I pray, Lord, for the grandparents, Lord, that might be living as if it's just about retirement and just enjoying the day, to understand that you're not done with them. Lord, help us to run with endurance, the race, the mission that you have before us. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you're here today, you have more questions about God or relationship. If you're online, you can put it in the chat. Private message us. We'll reach out to you. For the people in here, we've got two options for you. When we're done, one, we have the next steps table that's in the lobby over here on the right-hand side when you walk through this door. The people there just want to talk to you, talk about where you're at, talk about what you're going through. What is your next step? To join a life group, to be part of a ministry. You say, I saw the choir. How do I get involved in that? Go to that table. They're going to show you what your next step is. But also, if you have something on your heart and mind, for us as a church family, you don't have to run to me. We are a family that goes above and beyond to help people find and follow Jesus. If you're part of fellowship right now, say amen.
Amen.
That's the people you'd lean on. We're a church. We're not a building. Prove that. We don't even have to be in that room to worship Jesus. We can do it in this room and still worship Jesus. But the people, the faces in this room are the people that you lean on to go through life. I wanted to share with you guys something that I'm going to be doing over the next couple weeks. Logan is done with radiation. He had to go through 25 radiation treatments. And that was the treatment that we didn't think was possible to get us to this point. They wanted to take a four-week break after radiation because radiation inflames the cancer. And so they have to let that inflammation, just like a sore in your body or whatever, stop being irritated. Within weeks after that, they said when the inflammation stops, it slowly turns into scar tissue. They said that the reason that Cleveland Clinic is able to pull this off is because they have this down to a science that they have to do his surgery between week 4 and 5 to be exactly in that spot where it's not inflamed and it's not scar tissue. Because of that, Logan cannot get sick. If he is, it's not just a matter of postponing. It's putting us into a series of time that turns into scar tissue, and we can't. It just makes the surgery much more complicated, which it's already them cutting cancer off of his heart. It is a very complicated surgery. Because of that, starting next Sunday, myself and my family, we are going to quarantine as much as possible. The doctor, last time we had surgery, he said, you're fine as long as you're not in crowds. I'm like, okay, let me tell you what I do. And he said, yeah, you're going to have to pull back. So, and I know it's the same case this way. So with sickness and just things and germs and things like that, I'm going to slip in over the next 2 Sundays. I'm going to preach, and then I'm going to slip out. It's not because I don't like you guys or love you guys, but I've got to do this for the sake of my family. And I know that you guys understand. I know there's no doubt, but you just need to know when you're not seeing me that I'm not just being antisocial, okay? It's because I'm on a mission to see my son cancer-free. That's why I'm on this mission. We're all on this mission. And God is working. And to God be the glory, great things he has done. And I'm still claiming Ephesians 3:20, unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. God bless you guys. Thank you.
We'll definitely make it a point, and I hope you will as well, that we'll be praying for Pastor Tony and Logan during this time. Pastor Tony mentioned Connecting Point and Next Steps, and if you're a guest with us, man, there's Connecting Point right over here, Next Steps right over here. We'd love for you to go to those places and get plugged in. If you don't have the Church Center app, that's a great tool for you. You'll be able to see the calendar. You'll be able to sign up for events. You'll be able to give there, see the sermon notes. All of those things are there within the Church Center app, and what I'm about to tell you about, you can find out more information on inside the Church Center app as well. Next Sunday is Christmas Eve, and we hope that you'll join us next Sunday, Christmas Eve, and we hope that you'll invite family and friends. We're having our 2 morning services at 9:15 and 11. We would love to see you here. And then coming up in the new year, we have an event for the men. It's called Man Up. It's a conference for men. That's on January 12th and 13th. We would love for you to be there. It's in Logan, Ohio this year. And we would love for you to come and be a part of that. All the information that you need to know for that can be found within the Church Center app. So thank you all for coming today. John is one of our trustees, and he had a few words he would like to say.
Hey, everybody. So as many of you know, every year we take up a collection just for a gift for the staff. I'm not going to say a whole lot because people want to leave, and I have said everything I need to say in previous years, so I'm just going to give these gifts, the cards to Bryce, and trust him not to steal. Bryce, please. But of course, we appreciate the staff and love them. Thank you so much for all that you do. Everybody who's on staff here, whether part-time or full-time, have the merriest of Christmases. Thanks.
You're dismissed.